Hello, Galaxy. I'm Chris Perillo, and I'm joined tonight by a somewhat familiar face if you've been tuned into every single video that I've done on the channel, which I know you have. A while ago, I reviewed The Force Awakens, the theatrical release of The Force Awakens, with Stargeek, who is one of the most amazing content producers in the Star Wars community out there. And he happens to be someone I had a chance to hang out with him very briefly. After party, and that was a lot of fun. I'll be talking about that at a later time. Tonight, I asked if he would be able to come on and talk specifically about the Rogue One teaser trailer. Not the trailer. Trailer hasn't been released, just the teaser trailer, very short. We've both, to my knowledge, done reaction videos. That's kind of par for the course. But I really wanted to spend some time talking about some of the finer points, my thoughts on the trailer, and I thought we could just, you know, kill two birds with one stone specifically. And do it together. And he accepted.
Yes, thank you so much for having me on. It's going to be fun.
You know, I don't do a lot of collaborations, but if it's
neither.
I'll collaborate. I'm very, very glad that you're able to do this with me, because otherwise it would just be me geeking out and like talking about it.
It's always fun to talk Star Wars with someone else, especially when it's something as big as this new Rogue One teaser trailer. So I'm excited to delve into it a little bit further.
Awesome. And I'm glad. I'm glad. Definitely want to cover some people the way that I'm infringing copyright or somebody else's content.
Right.
So I don't broadcast anything that I don't necessarily own. And most people who don't do content on YouTube don't understand how it's not in the creator's favor. So we're not going to be playing back audio or video of the teaser trailer, but you can watch on your own. It's like, I'm sure you have more than one screen there at home or work or wherever you are tuned into this. But we're not going to risk any kind of violation, because otherwise we can get in trouble. And that would mean that we wouldn't be able to do videos, or we lose certain aspects of our channel, because we, even if we argued fair use, it doesn't matter how much we argue. If we're caught in the system, we're caught in the system.
Yeah, it's really risky business. So we're playing it safe.
Yes. And so you understand that.
I understand that. I take the risk in almost every video, and it's mostly played out for me. I've had a couple little hiccups here and there, but it's much safer this way, and you can just watch off to the side your own Rogue One while we talk about it here. So
there you go. So generally speaking, you the teaser trailer.
Sorry, one more time. You cut out for a second there.
You were happy.
Oh yeah. I was very happy with the teaser trailer. It was big news, and I'm excited for the movie to come out now, because before I had seen the trailer, I was kind of iffy on it. I knew the general plot that they were trying to go for, but I wasn't sure how it was going to work without the big Star Wars characters or the music and all this other stuff. But the trailer looks promising, so I'm excited about it now.
You know, I enjoyed the trailer, but teaser trailer, really, to define it, very, very short. I enjoyed it, and I knew I was watching something. It didn't feel Star Wars-y enough. It had the elements.
Right.
But it did feel different, and I think that is much to the credit of how it was designed, because, to my understanding, it is really designed to be, it's a Star Wars story, formerly.
Exactly.
So they try to keep a lot of the magic and mystery that's normally been our experience with Star Wars out of it. So I think they succeeded in that.
Yeah, they're trying to do something completely different, still tying to the Star Wars name and the same general locations and story, but giving us a different look and a different feel to it, which I'm excited about. I mean, a lot of the same images that they have in movies like A New Hope, that connects it, but it's not just copying the same story, and it's going to give us something new. So I'm excited to get something much different from the normal Star Wars feel that we usually have.
And I've friends of mine, they don't live it like we might. and they've asked, I'm like, well, wait a minute, is this a Star Wars movie? Is it the next thing? What's going on? And so I think, before we get into it, I think Disney's kind of got its work cut out for it. And I think they can do it. I really do. And as much as I understand it to be effectively a prequel, I do not believe they're ever going to use that word in marketing this movie. But that's effectively what it is. And
it's just an anthology film that comes out before A New Hope. They're not didn't want to disconnect. As much as you might like the prequels, I think Disney knows, or general Disney knows that we'll miss them.
Well, so, I think they'll pull it off. I think they'll pull it off. So, the trailer starts, and of course, I'm anticipating that it's going to happen. I wasn't close to passing out like I was when I actually saw The Force Awakens in theaters. I really truly hyperventilated when the crawl happened.
I was shaking. I was full moon. It was insane.
I think. It was fun to see as it begins. I immediately felt like I was not just home, but it felt like it was familiar territory. We see the character now known as Jyn walking through a hangar. Assumedly,
right.
I would assume it's Yavin 4, if only because of the time that it takes place right before A New Hope, mm-hmm. and only because of the look of it, like the vines and the back. I mean, everything screamed Yavin 4.
I'm hoping it's Yavin 4, so the next action back to A New Hope. It's a look that trilogy that around a few minutes, but we're gonna look at it. But I'm pretty sure that especially with that familiar horn that they use, the sound.
Oh, that.
Yeah.
Sorry, you're kind of breaking up, and so I'm filling in gaps. It happens with the Google Plus Hangouts so frequently, and unfortunately, there's no better way of doing it right now because YouTube doesn't want to fix it. It felt like I knew where it was immediately. I didn't need any amount of context. Mm-hmm. It was a familiar scene. So even if I didn't have quote unquote familiar faces, I had familiar territory, and then that led into at least one familiar face, one touch point, Mon Mothma, who is the same actress who played Mon Mothma in episode 3. That was a deleted scene. I don't think she ever actually appeared in the movie.
Yeah, Genevieve, I think it's Genevieve O'Reilly is her name. She was in a few deleted scenes, I think, but they were all cut from episode 3. So it's nice to see that she is getting her time to shine as Mon Mothma in the Star Wars, saga now.
Yeah, I mean, it gave context, right? So familiar territory, familiar face. We knew the story. We know what. Here's the thing. It was kind of like, to me, the this is how I feel about it. Like the movie Apollo. What was it? Apollo 13. We knew what happened. We just didn't necessarily have all the details of how it happened in a grand way. So that's how I feel about Rogue One. We know what happened. Now we're just looking to kind of fill in the gaps. And or even with the prequels, we kind of knew that Anakin Skywalker became Darth Vader. We just didn't know how. I frame it in that context. And again, it feels, that's a good feeling. It feels familiar. It feels different. It feels, it's a part of the story. And I like that. Immediately I liked it. Jyn Erso, I like the name. It sounds Star Wars-y to me.
Definitely. Kind of like Qui-Gon in the first name. Which some people are making connections to, but familiar connections, but I don't see that happening anytime soon.
And I feel the same way. I'm like, I don't know why people struggle to try to make connections. I just think that happen organically. You know, it's like who is Snoke? I don't know. Is Jyn related to Rey? I don't know. I'm like, I think it could happen, but would I be looking for it? No. Would I be shocked if it happened? No. I mean, I don't know if I want them to necessarily kind of do that, but at the same time, I think it's fine to have a standalone character that doesn't need to have a connection with other characters. And if they're boundary with Star as far as like one of the first story films that they're producing, if that makes sense, or if the connection, so our connection may be kind of quirky.
Yeah. It cut out a little bit there for a second.
It feels like they could expand the Star Wars galaxy and step outside of the Skywalker family bubble.
Right, I hope that's the direction they're taking. Because the main saga should be about the Skywalker family. But these anthology films, they seem to be taking it the direction where they're kind of escaping from this one like dramatic family that's taking over the galaxy, or, you know, affecting the whole galaxy, and it's just going to focus on smaller parts of the story. So I hope that they don't make too many connections there.
Yeah.
But that's just what I think of it.
Felt that, like, to me, C-3PO being built by Anakin Skywalker was too
Yeah.
far.
That definitely took it a little bit too far. It's just not plausible.
It's just like, why? Like, there's no reason. So I'm good. Few seconds of the teaser trailer, I'm already feeling good.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, there's so much to take in, right? Every minute detail. And I've only seen the teaser trailer right now maybe 3 or 4 times. I even with The Force Awakens, I didn't oversaturate myself because I don't want to desensitize myself or set expectations for myself.
Right.
I want to get enough, but then, like, okay, I'm good. So I've only seen it 3 or 4 times.
Yeah, I've seen it a few more times than that. Closer to the 20-25 range. I don't want to pick it apart too much, but I do like to watch it a few times to see what I can find without going in too deep here now.
You know, I'm probably going to be joining you there in the sense of, you know, watching it a few more times just to, you know, just kind of soak it up. It's kind of like The Force Awakens. I didn't enjoy it. I enjoyed it. Enjoyed it more the second time.
Totally. And, yeah.
Well, the fifth that long, and I still got goosebumps in scenes. So, you know, I watched it when I watched it like a third time. I noticed the X-wing for the first time in the hangar. Vehicles don't necessarily jump out at me as much as characters do. But, you know, again, it's something we know what it generally sounds like, etc. So, seeing the X-wing or the X at least one kind of, I'll come back to this in a bit because I want to kind of frame this part of the discussion, but again, it's familiarity was right there. We knew it. We didn't have to, you know, we didn't know, we didn't guess, like, what is that? We know what it is.
Right. It's that familiar image that they're putting in there so that we know it's the Star Wars universe, but it's still different. So they kind of shoved it in the background there. That's what I liked about that X-Wing being included. Same with the astromech droids and the gonk droids and all the technicians and stuff. It's kind of all in the background. It's there, but it's not like jumping out at you as like the main focus of that scene.
Now, speaking of gonk droid.
Right.
Is the one that appears in same markings and everything.
Yep. Same one.
Funny. It's like that to me, that's fine. That is okay. It's not like, you know, it's not a stretch. I'm like, the droid could last however long, but that's kind of neat.
It's again, connecting it, not in a way that's like jumps out at you totally, but it's still connected. And a pattern that Star Wars movies like to follow is that you have these droids who go through a lot, or characters who go through a lot, and you see their journey, even if it's just a background character like this gonk droid here, apparently started out here and somehow ended up in episode 7. But I just think that's kind of fun to look at.
It is.
Yeah.
It's like droids, aliens, jump, and say that one of the things that jumped out at me, and I think the first time I noticed it, and I didn't even notice the rebels being marched through this marketplace, but I noticed that the marketplace, I didn't notice any aliens. And then I realized, I'm like, I'm not seeing a lot of droids either. So I'm not upset about that. I think they should and will be there. But if you might remember in A New Hope, see specifically that era, there weren't a lot of people or characters, creatures that were, you know, there, you know, fighting for the Rebel Alliance. We saw them in Jedi by the time Return of the Jedi happened, but I don't remember seeing a lot of them in A New Hope, and someone could correct me, but they were all white guys, basically.
No. Yeah, there really wasn't much diversity in species there. I would have liked to see maybe a Rodian there, or an Ithorian, or something cool like that, but I don't think they want to shove too much of that in. It's just a little bit strange to just see all these are they called humans in the Star Wars universe? I never really figured that out.
I don't know what their designation is. Let's just say for all intents and purposes, people like us, people.
Right. People. Okay. Like, yeah. So yeah, they basically just have the people in there and not very many other species, which, I mean, it's okay. It's not distracting. It just
would
be nice to see some more diversity there, but it's not a big deal.
I agree. And well, speaking of diversity, we'll take this tangent too. Some people are upset because now we have another female lead and I'm like, it's another Star Wars film. Shut up.
Yeah.
Shut up.
Basically every other Star Wars film, the other six that we've gotten have been male leads.
Yes.
I don't think you need to really be complaining too much about female leads. It doesn't matter. It's not an important part of the story. They're just the characters there that are going to take us through the story. Does it really matter what gender they are? I mean,
no, I don't think their sex is, I don't care. I'm like, I don't look at a Star Wars character and think, let's take another tangent and say, well, let's say the lead was a Rodian. Would people be concerned? I'm like, it's dialogue. I mean, is the story good?
Yeah.
I don't, you know, and I completely agree. You know, we had the Luke and Han era. We had the Anakin Skywalker era. And I think that, you know, it's funny, actually. Mike Price in L.A., that's his handle on Twitter. He directed or produced the Droid Tales, Lego Droid Tales.
Oh, yeah.
Did you see the image that it was like a memed image where in Droid Tales, which was great, it was fantastic. Tongue-in-cheek humor.
Yeah, it was something. A lot of fun.
Oh, it was so much fun. They made fun of Jar Jar. They made fun of the fact Luke doesn't recognize Anakin Skywalker's Force ghost. I mean, they make fun of things that fans nitpick, right?
So yeah, it wasn't just the normal Lego humor. I think that show is honestly a little bit of a step up, but that was a lot of fun. I know what you're talking about, though, that you're going to talk about next.
Yeah, I mean, but it signed off. It's like, can they do that? Because the scene, and again, I had tweeted and shared on social. It was Luke speaking with Yoda, which would have been the time where Yoda was about to pass away. And Yoda actually had a Lego teddy bear. And he says, no, you have a sister. And Luke says, it's Leia. And Yoda said, yeah, you know, you're strong with the Force. He says, no, it's the only other girl I've known. Story. And this we must. And I just thought, not only was that kind of a prognostication of what was to play out with Rey and now Jin, right. But it was also, I said, yes, like, exactly. So I have no issue. I have an issue with the people who have an issue with it, personally.
Right. I mean, that was a fun scene in Droid Tales. But no, it's telling of what's to come. I don't think we're going to get a Han Solo movie after this and probably an Obi-Wan movie. So I think people can stop complaining. Hopefully an Obi-Wan movie.
Yeah.
That's like well above a Han Solo movie for me. That would just be the best.
The party, McGregor, an Obi-Wan trilogy. If, of course the story's good and all that stuff, but if Ewan leads it, I want that trilogy for Obi-Wan.
Right. I'd be happy with a trilogy. Some people say it would be a little bit too much and they think he's just hiding out on the desert, but I think there's an adventure that they could take him on there, a path. He can't just be watching over Luke for all those years. He has to be doing something else. No. But, I mean, at least one movie, please, Disney. Ewan McGregor wants to do it. The fans all want it. It's just, like, a perfect opportunity.
I would prefer – and I love Han Solo. He's one of my favorite characters. I dressed up like him for Halloween when I was a kid going all the way back. I'm still a little concerned about – he basically has to be – Harrison Ford is Han Solo, and I have to suspend disbelief so much to see that character as Han Solo, and that's going to be very challenging. And if they don't find the right actor, they're going to have big problems with that movie.
Yeah, okay. I'm the same exact way. Basically, any time that a movie switches an actor for trying to play it off as the same character, it just doesn't work for me. It's hard to sell a new character, especially when it's supposed to be Han Solo. Selling a new actor as Han Solo is going to be really difficult. It's kind of like Indiana Jones. The producer for the new movie, I think, was saying no one else can be Indiana Jones. Like, Harrison Ford is Indiana Jones. And it should be the same way for Han. If they get the, they have a, supposedly or they're going to have a really good script with Lawrence Kasdan writing it. And I have faith in the director, but it, the actor is the important part.
You know, it was kind of like when I watched, you know, like The Door or Kilmer. I don't know if you're. Or Jim Carrey becomes Andy Kaufman in The Man in the Moon. Like, they become those people, and I suspend disbelief. It's like I'm watching Andy Kaufman, or I'm watching Jim Morrison, not the actors portraying those people. And so they have, again, I know we shouldn't be diving too deep into this, but we will. We're geeking out over it. No one can stop us. Ha ha ha. But there, I don't reasons, but except. And this is, I didn't make this note, but one of the things that may be happening, I think is a rumor at this point, but Darth Vader could appear in the film. That makes sense, because you can, just like they could with Chewbacca, you can replace an actor inside that costume, and it's still Darth Vader, right?
Or
definitely
it's Chewbacca. I think just having him like at the last moment of the movie, I think that would be really cool to have Darth Vader there. But any actor can play him. That's a little bit different when you're like in a costume.
Yep.
As long as they get the voice right. If they do put Darth Vader in this movie and he has a speaking role, it needs to be James Earl Jones. Other than that, it doesn't really matter. I mean, Hayden Christensen played Darth Vader at the end of episode 3. So look is important. If they get an actor good enough to play this Han Solo character well, who sells themselves as Han Solo, that's all that really matters. It's a little bit too bad that they didn't choose Anthony and Gruber for the role, but... he isn't a professional actor. I understand that, but...
Nailed, but... I think he could... Not casting, I'm... Concerns, but we'll shelve those concerns for that teaser trailer. So I am excited to see Vader. I also understand... I didn't see a lot of sentiment about this, but I understand why he wasn't... If he is to be in Rogue One... Why he wasn't in the teaser trailer. One, because we don't know how much of a role he has. Two, because he would have sucked the air out of it.
Yeah, totally.
Like, everyone would have focused on Vader, much like, why wasn't Luke Skywalker seen in the trailer?
Right, or, you know, right.
Force Awakens. There was a reason for that. He would have sucked the air out of the movie. And I, so, as much as I love Vader, I mean, hello. Vader collection here, obviously. You know, I understand why he didn't appear, or there was no suggestion that he was even going to be in the film. I don't even know if they're going to show it in the teaser trailer. I think that would be something I would be excited to see revealed in the actual, in the trailer itself.
Right, yeah. I don't think he could have too much of a role anyways in this movie, because he shouldn't be the main focus. He's already the main focus of the, like, Darth Vader or Anakin Skywalker is the overarching focus of the whole original trilogy, prequel trilogy, and kind of a little bit into the sequel trilogy here.
So the only thing I think would, kind of on the fence, if he's in Rogue One, but I also feel that that's a great... an amazing way to market this film, because we've got it's obviously Star Wars. It's got Star Wars in the title, but Vader is going to draw audiences.
That would definitely sell it,
dude. But,
yeah, I mean,
dude, I'm gonna
get a huge turnout.
I'm gonna expand my home office here, because I know the Vader merch is gonna be coming down the pipe.
Yeah.
I also understood why he wasn't in the teaser trailer.
Right. Well, some people are saying that Forrest Whitaker at the end of the trailer, like, if you get to a certain point in the trailer, like, there's a little bit of a reverb on his voice, but it sounds like Darth Vader's breathing, which I thought was a huge stretch. Mm. But there is, like, a certain point in the trailer, like, if you cut out everything else and you just listen to it, it sounds just like a Vader breath. That was brought up a lot, and everyone's like, oh, Darth Vader's going to be in it.
I'm not sure I hear that.
No, yeah, it's right at the end.
They would make it intentional. They would
right
overt, not just like a hidden Mickey, if you will. I wouldn't lend much credibility to that. But
no.
One of the things that this was on an initial pass, something that really hit home to me is like, this is the first time when I first saw one. This is the first time we've seen an Imperial Stormtrooper, the classic design, not the First Order, but a classic. Imperial Stormtrooper on Return of the Jedi.
I know.
To my knowledge. I can't remember if they showed up at the end of The New Hope. Or, I'm sorry, at the end of
Episode 3?
Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith.
I don't think there were any Stormtroopers there. I think that they were, you know, they were still converting it at all into the New Empire. But that was pretty awesome. It's been a long, long time.
Yeah, so. But think about that. It's like it's been that since Jedi. I mean, in a film, you know, we have not seen a classic Imperial Stormtrooper. And when he appeared on the screen, it hit me. I'm like, we have not seen one of those in a film, like, for forever. I mean, like,
I know.
You know, 80, what was it, 84, 86? I lose, I'm too old, I've lost
85,
count.
83.
So that jumped out at me, is seeing a new Stormtrooper. But then, and I'd be curious as to your feel on this. I was watching the film, or sorry, not the film, sorry, I'm not that, I don't have that access. The teaser trailer. And I'm watching the Star Destroyer come across, and I see the Starfield. I'm like, cool, Star Destroyer, okay, Starfield, it's recognizable. Right. And then I see the dish kind of fall into place. I'm like, okay, that was cool. You know, I'm processing it. I'm like, oh, it's the Death time. I was photography in the style used, because I thought the Star Destroyer was flying in front of a Starfield. But it was the Death Star that was flying in front of it. It was the shadow that obliterated the light. I'm like, oh, yeah. I mean, it was
I thought that was an amazing shot. I was really, when I first saw the Star Destroyer and it was just like against this blackness, I was like, wow, that looks cool, but what's going on there? And then you see the dish being put into place. Oh, that was so cool. And actually, on the same note of like the nostalgic thing where this is the first time we've seen Imperial Stormtroopers, it was almost, the Star Destroyer was almost, had more of an impact on me than the Stormtroopers did, because we haven't seen a Star Destroyer for just as long. And I think they look really good in this movie. I'm excited to see this just for the Death Star and the Star Destroyers and the AT-ATs. There's so much that they're giving us.
Well, you know, I can tell you that there was a Star Wars movie. This is going to give the Star Wars movies, honestly.
Yeah, yeah.
And they can do that. They can escape the narrative, and I think that's part of the freedom that Disney now has, or Lucasfilm by proxy. That to me, I think, is kind of exciting. It's a different kind of Star Wars film. Going back to me feeling that it was there, but it didn't feel like a Star Wars movie. And so maybe it's just going to feel like a different kind of Star Wars movie. And I'm fine. A lot of battles, a lot of war. I expect that.
This is putting the war in Star Wars, definitely. Is that, that's what it seems like.
The note you're kind of breaking up there. But I think we're kind of seeing eye to eye. Jin, this is interesting. So I've got a note about Jin. I watched, and this may be the arc, Jessica Jones, the series on Netflix. Very mature, very graphic, but the character's got this just very, she's, guarded and very, very street smart, very intelligent, very, savvy, questionable background character. And Jessica Jones is probably one of my favorite parts of the MCU, or the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Jin kind of gave me a very Jessica Jones-esque vibe. And then when I listened to it again, I was like, oh, she was brought up, Jin was brought up on charges of this, that, and the other thing. I'm like, oh yeah, this kind of sounds like a Jessica Jones of sorts. Would associate Jin, we're trying to associate her with Rey. I'm like, no. Was I listening to a different teaser trailer? I'm like,
I haven't seen Jessica Jones, but I've heard that parallel before. She's a much different character than Rey, but I mean, yeah, she's kind of, we don't know a lot about her, do we? We know that she is a rebel.
She's a rogue. I mean, it's the rogue character. What makes you think you do this? This is a rebellion. I rebel.
Right.
I'm like, okay. I mean, I don't know if that line hit me hard. I mean, it may hit me harder when seeing it in context, but I'm like, think about that. I mean, she is a rebel. Like in the we don't know why. We don't have that story yet, but I thought it was very. I thought it was appropriate, right? Another sidebar. Star, not the Bothans already. Okay, sorry, I had to throw that out there because there's
right. Yeah,
not the Bothans. Like, are we like watching the same things here? Are we not? You know.
Yeah. Yeah. No. Yeah. This is a different story than the Bothan story. But we do have Mon Mothma, so yes. I guess that maybe that's what's throwing people off a little bit.
It could be, and actually, it probably it would be. And I'm not slagging it. I'm just saying that Bothans are a different storyline. to watch on the trailer, and I pick up on a lot of this stuff, but we don't really have a lot to cling to. Jin is in the moment when she, I think it was the, I don't know the character's name yet, but he basically he was the one that was kind of.
Right. Yeah.
Room over Mon Mothma. Assumedly, it's the same scene, and they ask her in a general, or whoever asks her, "I'm like, what makes you think you could do this, or whatever? Are you ready? Are you prepared to do this?" And she said, "Yes, sir." But the way she said it was one full of like disdain. Like, yeah, yes, I can do this. Disdain. But notice her nonverbal behavior. She may have said yes, but she shook her head no. She tilted.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, you know, it's that's telling about the character and very apropos for that type of character too. What that means, she said yes.
Sorry, you cut out for just a second there.
I just repeated myself is all.
Okay, yeah, yeah, yeah. But no, yeah, I saw that. I didn't catch that the first time, but I think I saw that the second time. I was like, it's interesting. They're throwing in small little keys there. And I think that character you were talking about with the crossed arms, played by, I think his name is Diego Luna, is the actor's name. He, I have a speculation, might be her handler or someone who watches over her on their mission, because they have a mission for her to go take the Death Star plans, supposedly, and they can't just trust a criminal who they've already like labeled as all these things without someone to go, you know, watch over them. So I'm guessing that's who that would be.
Yeah, no, I get the same kind of. Absolutely. Scene that I saw in the trailer as I'm taking down notes, and we are kind of jumping, but. Obvious Grand Admiral in white cloak.
Yes.
And everything. My
yes.
initial reaction was, "Is that Grand?" I said, "Thrawn." Like
the that's exactly what I said. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But it's not a was Thrawn's race is a Chiss or a kid. I don't know how to pronounce.
Yeah,
it.
I think you're right. I don't know the name of the species, but blue skin, red eyes.
Right, but that was Legends, so they could theoretically, as they've done with Rebels, dip into Legends and pull into canon. It could still be Thrawn.
Right. That's I was having the same thoughts. It would be a different. It would be the same character, but in a different role, is what I'm thinking. It would save that character from Legends, which it doesn't happen in canon anymore. Later on in the story, where they've placed him, so they could be saving him here. I think when I first saw it, though, I was like excited, just like that. There's Thrawn. I really love that series, so. I hope that that's who it ends up being, or at least a Grand Admiral with the same type of character that Thrawn had.
He's got, he has but then he, walking through like water over a battle scene, so he's,
right.
he's obvious, like, I don't think they're going to Phasma him.
Hopefully not.
Would I be disappointed if he's Thrawn, or I'm sorry. Would I be disappointed if he's not Thrawn? No.
No.
Would I be fine with it? Yes. He's not. I could go either way.
Yeah, I think that's the attitude to have when you go into this type of thing. He's a cool character, but I don't want to rush to conclusions and hope that he's going to be like this really main part of the story, because like Captain Phasma, when she showed up in the second trailer, everyone was like super excited about her, and then in the movie she ended up being kind of a throwaway character, literally thrown into a trash compactor. So hopefully his character is dealt a little bit better but we'll have to see. Hopefully he's not like the Boba Fett or Captain Phasma type character where they're just, well, kind of, you know, favorites because they look cool.
On that point, I don't think he's the same character. I'm kind of jumping out of and I think this is a fine way of taking the conversation, but it happened here, so to speak, in front of what could be what some have alleged to be a back to tank, whether or not it is, don't know, this light source or whatever, flanked by Emperor's Royal Guards. I don't know the Emperor's Royal Guards. That cloaked figure, I do not believe, is this Grand Admiral. I don't believe. So that's another...
Yeah, it's the question, is that the Emperor and that's why the Royal Guards are there? Or is it someone kneeling down to talk to the Emperor and that's why the Royal Guards are there? The Emperor almost always has a connection with the Royal Guards, though. Or at least Vader would have some sort of connection, if not the Emperor. I couldn't really see the Royal Guards with anyone else. So that figure is either... I don't think it's Emperor Palpatine because he wouldn't really... There isn't anyone above Palpatine at this point in the story. Palpatine must be there or something there that the Royal Guards are positioned to guard.
I don't think it's Vader. I don't think it's Palpatine. I don't think it's this Grand Admiral. I think it's another character that is yet to be
revealed. Yeah. Yeah, that's the only thing that I could think.
Emperor is somehow present. It is very clear.
Yeah, right.
I would certainly expect that even in this film. And I think if they can get Ian back to do it,
that would be great. I mean, awesome. Just a little cameo from the Emperor at least at the end or something. That would be fun.
Anything.
Yeah.
Your audio is kind of getting crackly. I don't.
Is it
happening? Kind of crackly, and it could be the connection.
Yeah, your footage is cutting off here and there a little bit.
Let me go ahead and at this time, if I go into the settings, I think, or does it do it? Oh, there we go. In the settings in the bars, you can actually disable HD. So I'm going to disable it right now.
Sure. Okay.
Down to medium. It cropped it, but it hopefully that will mitigate some of the issues that we're having. All right. Move that up too.
Okay.
I don't know if you want to do that on your end as well.
I think,
but your audio is really getting really
good. Okay.
And it's specifically, I hear it when you're talking. Just trying to, this is what happens with live video feeds. But if we can, you know, try to mitigate that.
Just working out the quirks.
Yeah.
I think I've just lowered the quality, but I don't know.
Can you mute yourself and then unmute yourself?
Sure. Let me try that. Any better?
No, I'm still getting crackled.
Okay.
Can you unplug and plug it back in? Computer people love when I do tech troubleshooting. I'm doing it live. There we go. There's your tech talk for the day. Can you plug it back in and then check your settings to make sure your mic is reconnected as the mic to use?
Be better with the built-in microphone.
There you go. Okay, you're better? Yeah.
I am using the Blue Yeti microphone, but I'm just using the built-in one now.
I've had issues with the Yeti.
Have you?
I got rid of it. I'm like, I was having too many problems with it. I know a lot of people love it, but
it works really well in Final Cut Pro, but it doesn't work too well with live hangouts I've seen or any Skype calls or anything like that. So
okay, so hopefully we can get past some of these maybe the broadcast got better. Who knows? Okay, so moving along to a far more interesting topic. The Dark Trooper. So
yes,
we see that just a brief clip before the Good Morning America broadcast. And I'm just like, dude, any new trooper, I'm in. And we see Dark Troopers. Who are they? Are they Shadow Troopers? Are they Vader's elite? Are they the Emperor's elite? Who are they?
Right.
We don't know. We didn't see them in A New Hope. So were they out? Are they on Yavin? What was that moisture thing that we've been standing in? Are they somewhere else? What's going on? But like, I love those questions, right? You know, the design ethos, I thought, beyond maybe fitting the period, maybe being Macquarie inspired, it looked epic. I mean, the design of the black troopers
really well. Yeah. I think Yeah, I don't know. That Good Morning America clip, though, that just teased the teaser, that was already kind of enough to get a lot of people hooked. I was excited just from that armor. And we'd seen a sneak peek of that helmet before, I think, online.
It got leaked.
Yeah, but I mean, that it's exciting to get new troopers, even if it doesn't really seem like it would fit into the timeline because we don't see them in A New Hope. Like you were saying, if they're like the elite troopers of the Emperor or of Vader, and they are only assigned to like special tasks, I think that's how they'd explain this type of trooper that we don't see in the original trilogy at all, just showing up now here.
Yeah, I don't think they have to do a lot of retconning, which
no.
is, you know, and I the less they have to shoehorn, the happier I am. You know, I can fill in the, I can, my mind can, you know, mentally just fill in the blanks.
Yeah, not everything needs to be explained.
There was a scene where there was another trooper that showed up. We see it, the sight of another trooper running with Imperial stormtroopers, like a tan type of trooper with a different type of helmet, but they're like obviously tan.
Yes, yes. I'm looking at that now.
We don't know necessarily what kind of troopers those are, but we're looking at another trooper. And then I didn't even catch the other trooper. So there's
the tank guy,
tank troopers. So there are at least three new troopers, as opposed to just one new trooper in The Empire Strikes Back, and another one new trooper in Return of the Jedi with the snow trooper, and then the scout trooper.
Right. Yeah, so, we're getting like all these new troopers in one movie, more than we got in the whole original trilogy, really. But I mean, they look really nice, and I've heard complaints. Do you know Jody from Sarlacc and Stars?
I probably met, but yeah,
probably.
I don't know if I've done a
yeah.
lot.
He's really into stormtroopers, and he says they've actually done some really strange work on the original stormtrooper costume, where they may look the same at first glance, but if you look, they've actually edited a ton, probably for wearability and making it look a little more accurate, but they wouldn't fit in with the A New Hope timeline, supposedly.
I guess I don't look at that much. I don't nitpick.
Right.
I don't look at that detail.
Right, but the 501st does, though.
Yes, I know.
The 501st is getting a little angry about this because they're going to have to, if you want to be the Rogue One type of trooper, you have to rework the whole armor instead of you have to get a whole new costume, basically.
It could have been an evolution. I mean, it could have been, the time that there was a change that was made for whatever reason. It could have been a boneheaded decision or whatever, but maybe that's now, talk about retcon. This is what you can throw at people. Maybe that's the thing that made Imperial Stormtroopers in A New Hope fire so poor. If they changed something.
Right, about the armor that they weren't used to. Right, yeah.
And they don't even need to say it. Like, no one, there doesn't need to be a scene at the armory where someone's, you know, Captain Bob says, well, I don't agree with these orders because the Stormtroopers aren't going to fire as well with this.
Right.
They don't have to do that, but that is a way to resolve the issue and still, I think, stay canon or close to canon.
Oh, yeah, totally. And I'm actually, I guess I never really looked that closely, but in this shot here with the tank trooper, the stormtrooper is holding a new type of gun, which I guess I noticed, but I wasn't really looking at it. What time in the trailer? 1:06. The stormtrooper in the front with the kind of like big giant blaster gun.
Sorry. Which 104?
Yeah, sorry, you were cutting out a little bit there. What was the question?
Timestamp 104?
106.
Okay.
Or 105, I guess, would actually be better.
Okay, so I'm looking at that frame right now.
Yeah. So just this new gun in the foreground, I guess I just never really noticed it. And the new tank looks really cool, too.
You mean the gun that the trooper is holding onto?
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't notice. See, that's the funny thing is different things, but those tank troopers look awesome.
They do look awesome with the little visor on top.
Yeah.
That's pretty great. I don't want to look too closely.
Yeah. That's okay. Yeah. I like the designs of I've always liked the Imperial ethos, the design ethos.
Yeah.
So, speaking of the next scene, and this is kind of like moving into that, I mentioned another timestamp. We're kind of jumping a bit, but you know, right around 1:14, 1:15, we see a character who, to my knowledge, is blind, or at least appears to be blind, swinging a weapon, a staff.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know. but and not really knocking that trooper for a loop, but we're seeing martial arts, and the only other kind of martial arts-esque feel we might have had is a lightsaber battle. So we're seeing seemingly what martial arts would be without lightsabers. So we're going to see potentially more martial arts style fighting minus lightsabers. I'm fine with that.
Yeah, I'm hoping that we don't see. I'm happy to see this type of martial arts stuff that they're putting in, but I'm hoping that they don't throw in a lightsaber, because it would be out of place.
They would have to with Vader. They would have to
if they have Vader, but they don't. He doesn't necessarily need to be in an action sequence. He can just be, you know, on the bridge or with the Emperor or something. But I mean, if they're gonna have a lightsaber, Vader would be the only good option for that.
It would have to be a Jedi or a Sith.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think they're going to eliminate... I don't think Jedi are going to happen. I think Vader is the only possibility of seeing a lightsaber in this movie. And I'm okay with that. You know, I don't have any issue with it. I don't go to Star Wars movies to see lightsaber battles, which is why, you know, when I went to The Force Awakens, I wasn't like, well, the lightsaber battle sucked. Like,
well, yeah, I actually think that Jedi and... Jedi are cool. The Force is all great. I love the Force and all that, but... It's not really the main focus of Star Wars that I look at. Lightsabers are really cool, but they aren't like, they don't make Star Wars. That's not what makes Star Wars, which a lot of people can't get away from. They're saying Rogue One isn't a movie for them because there aren't going to be any Jedi.
Shut up. I mean, there's no wrong way to fan, but dude, I mean, like, you're missing out on so much if you don't, if you start picking and choosing. I understand the division between Legends and canon. I do. I barely understand the division between the cartoon series, Rebels, or the Clone Wars, and the movies. I can understand it to a certain degree, but I still think you're missing out on a lot. Right. I can more deeply understand the division between comics and the films. I think, though, you're missing out on a lot. Today, or as of this week, I believe they're finally releasing the C-3PO.
Finally. I've been waiting so long.
I know, dude. I know. Telling the story of how C-3PO got his red arm by The Force Awakens. So we've been waiting for this since December last year. You know, you're missing out on bits and pieces that only serve to enhance your appreciation for what you already appreciate. And, you know, I don't necessarily get as deep into the novel stuff. I mean, I might as Jedi gets older and we start doing more reading and exploring that way, or if she's interested in that kind of thing. And I do want to read, you know, independent stories that build upon this idea of what we've seen in the films. But if and when Lucasfilm decides that they're going to create television style shows, you have to start giving up this idea that it's all about just episodic content, because you will be missing out. It's like, that's like saying, oh, I'm sorry, the only Avenger films are the Avengers films. I'm like, are you serious? Like, dude, there's so much in the MCU that can be appreciated and treasured.
Right. Star Wars has shown us so much of the galaxy, but hasn't really touched on it. And there's so much more that they could show that I think just focusing on a small little section of it, it's not really giving credit to what there is out there that they're trying to show us. But
I had a conversation with someone else today about Marvel. He said almost jokingly, he said, I don't think they're going to stop until there's something new to watch every week. I'm like, and I hope they do the same damn thing with Star Wars, because I'm telling you, imagine every week having something new to get excited about.
It'll be fun. Then they kind of did that with Rebels. I wasn't a fan of the first season, but when season two picked up, I was excited every Wednesday to see an episode of Rebels. So I think if they did that in a live action format, that would be giving the fans something that they've wanted for a long time.
Dude, I'm from the era, like, I couldn't get enough. So, like, give me more. I'd rather be oversaturated than undersaturated any day of the week. Any day of the week. So, okay, so I know we're kind of tangenting here, but no, it's still kind of on topic. We're talking about a different kind of Star Wars film. We talked about the Emperor's Royal Guards appearing in Palpatine. The Imperial Walkers appear for the first time, theoretically.
Yes.
But we haven't seen a Walker in action since Return of the Jedi, kind of, but really The Empire Strikes Back. So we're seeing the first Imperial Walker battle since The Empire Strikes Back.
And if you don't count the Rebels episode,
I count it. Film. Right. Yeah, I'm talking specifically about the film, because as much as I love Rebels and I watch Rebels and watch it and everything,
it's not the same.
It's not the same. So, yeah. I'm not slagging it, obviously. No. You know, I if it's Star Wars, I'm in. and this is we're seeing a new part of this the galaxy has to offer, right? We're seeing this
right.
new thing. It is not going to be episodic. We're not going to see a quote unquote Rogue Two or a Rogue One Part Two. It's beginning and it's done. It's definitive. They obviously got the plans. How? Who? What happened? What was the story? Right. So it's beginning end, but we've already got this memory, this cultural memory of walkers, of stormtroopers, of Emperor's right. royal guards, potentially Palpatine, potentially Vader. We've got the X-wings, we got the rebel pilots, we got Mon Mothma. Just familiar territory, familiar story. So this is the stage is set for success. Like
totally.
You know, you can't.
It'll be hard to mess this up. They're giving us something new, still with the old stuff, like we've been saying, but giving us something like the AT-ATs here.
You're an AT-AT guy. You're my man.
Well, right. Okay. I actually made a video, a Star Wars nitpicking video, where I was like, this is how you say all the names of the things, and I had to put AT-AT in there. But I just can't call it AT-AT.
I can't either.
It doesn't work. So, I said that the right way to say it is AT-AT, but I mean, it's
so here's the thing. So we have vindication. One, Kenner back in the 80s released they released their toy commercial, called it an AT-AT. It was the only time that was ever vocalized. So Kenner was the first to say that, and they had the toy, the AT-AT.
Right.
And then the second time was J.J. Abrams in the behind the scenes from The Force Awakens. So I'm like sitting there going, like, and people are like, well, what do you call an AT-ST? I call it an AT-ST. You got a problem with that?
Yeah.
Like, you know, I'm like.
Well, Pablo Hidalgo, who keeps up, you know, all the canon for Star Wars, says, like, calling it an AT-AT out of universe is totally fine. Kenner can do it. J.J. Abrams can do it. The fans can do it. But in universe, it has to be AT-AT, which is understandable.
That's fine. That's fine.
I mean, AT-AT is just, it's easier to say. It's just what I'm used to. It's just more fun. I don't know. It's AT-AT. But that's a little bit of a tangent.
I get it. I don't judge. Like if someone, you know,
yeah.
I don't judge. Okay. So we're familiar with it and I love the potentially names and scenes, and it still be completely new. And that to me gives Disney such creative license, and Lucasfilm, you know, by proxy, it's going to go everywhere. I mean, it's going to be amazing what Disney can do with Star Wars.
Oh yeah, totally. And I think that they're taking it in such a new direction with such a new different feel that they're going to have on top of this, where people who are complaining about episode 7 being too much like A New Hope or Empire Strikes Back or any of that are going to be at least, there are a lot of people who complain about that, but they're going to be happy with this movie at the very least. It's going to be something new. It's new environments, new characters with just
everything.
A few familiar images.
Dude, do not walk into this film. I know you know this and a lot of fans know this. Don't walk into this film expecting that you're going to see a sequel or expecting that
that
your sequel. It's called A New Hope. You know, it's not, this is it. Like, it's not going to be this. I mean, you may have a heroic or an anti-hero type of character, you know, but it's just different across. And I'm okay with that. That to me is awesome. I love the exploration of that. I love the fact that they can do this. I love it.
I know. I think it's a really good idea of going in a new direction. Like, I keep saying new direction, but I mean,
it's
like this new thing that they're giving us. It's something completely different.
Wait,
they're showing
on.
Us a new part of the universe.
Hang on. Are you saying that on the other side of the camera, you have Harry Styles?
No.
Never mind. I'm too old. I'm sorry, dude. I'm sorry. I'm not judging.
Right. No, but
I'm sorry, I totally derailed you, man. They're going a different direction. They're going it's something, it's unique. Sorry.
Yeah.
So at the end, I only caught better the second time I listened to it. The music, the score. You see Jin standing in a corridor, which potentially is the Death Star, wearing an Imperial gunner uniform with like katana or like some like swords. Like look like
right. That's what people are saying, that they look like swords on her back, but they probably aren't. That's what people are saying.
They could be, because look, you've got that. Someone who's mastered some kind of martial art, for that definition, you know, some kind of art form, potentially a trainer, you know, we don't know what she can do or she can't do at this stage, but she's standing there. And then you hear what I heard initially was dun, 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 dun. I heard the Imperial March. I listened to it a second time and they were playing Binary Suns over it. So it was this light and dark mixed over this.
Right.
That is already doing things for good, but is clearly not a quote-unquote good character of upstanding character by how as society we might define a good upstanding person. But that's fine. I'm fine with that kind of protagonist walking that line.
Oh yeah, totally. And I'm really interested in why she's wearing this this outfit here. I'm guessing that it's some sort of like a way to infiltrate the Imperial base. But also, what type of outfit do you think that is? Is it a TIE fighter pilot?
Imperial gunner is what's been suggested. Either way, even if it's an unknown character, it could be a derivation. I mean, ultimately, you know, it's kind of like, because they're layering over. I think it's Forrest Whitaker's character saying, you know, what will you become? And in that, to me, just think about that. You've got I think the only time that we, to my knowledge, we've heard a cross between the Imperial March I think it was Binary Sunset. Like this. And this is what we've already established this character at the very beginning, coming in. You've got a bad rap, basically. You know, you got this problem, this problem, this problem, this problem, this problem. But obviously they're pulling her in for a reason, to do something that ultimately serves the good for the galaxy, destroying the Death Star. And they got to get the plans, and they know that this is the only character to do it. So I love that. I love the complexity that adds in the question of, okay, is she good? Is she going to turn at the end? Is she doing it for other reasons? Or does she find redemption at the end of the film? I mean, it's just like, I mean, this to me makes an amazing story, right? You know, I'm like,
I don't know what direction they're going to take it, but I mean, it's exciting. They have this new cast of people that we don't know their morals, their backstory, or really anything about them. They can go anywhere with this, and I think that's going to be a big thing that makes Rogue One fun to see for the first time.
Oh, absolutely. And okay, so now I got to the point where I've got my postmortem, some things that I wanted to talk about after, things that I thought about. One, I think this could lead perfectly into episode 4. I think it has a potential of leading more perfectly into episode 4, to the point where one of the last scenes we may see without Carrie Fisher or her face, although they've perfected that technology in Ant-Man with Michael, Michael Richards? Michael Richards. Okay, so Michael Douglas, they perfected it in Ant-Man. In Tron 2.0, it was still really wonky. Michael Douglas, they perfected it. So there is a possibility that we're going to see Princess Leia basically get the plans. I think
that would be cool.
And that is one of the in the epilogue, much like how The Force Awakens ended with Rey basically holding the saber out to Luke. I think we're going to have a potential of seeing a Princess Leia moment at the end of the film.
At the very least, it would be nice to see like a back shot of the classic buns or something, the Leia buns.
Or just, I think they could do it.
A silhouette or something. I think that would be cool to have that.
Oh, dude, I think they could pull off the face. If they could do it in Ant-Man, I think they could pull off the face. I think they could do it.
Carrie Fisher looks pretty different now, though, doesn't she?
But that's not, they'll take from an earlier, they took from, I think it was, what was the movie they took from Michael Douglas and Ant-Man? They took from a substantially earlier movie. I think it was, I can't remember specifically, but they took from an earlier Michael Douglas. So I think it's insanely possible for them to pull off. So I would expect that.
I think that would be fun.
Well, to me, this is where I have an issue. I have a big issue with the end of the prequels, in the sense that they try to make everything tie up into a nice little bow, including having Vader at the end doing this with Palpatine and the Death Star coming together. And you can see, I'm like, I had an issue with that. I'm like, it's too neat. It's too, I don't like that, right?
I understand that. I mean, I think it was a nice way to tie up the prequels and say, here they are, they're done now. They're kind of pushed aside. Here's back to the new thing.
To build on this, and thank you, by the way, it's Level 3 Media. We're watching the live comments, by the way. We're getting when they're on topic, but someone said Wall Street, and I do believe that is accurate. It was Wall Street that the microphone was taken from. Because I looked at it when I watched Ant-Man, and I thought, wow, gosh, how'd they pull that off? Oh, dude, they nailed it. Like, when I suspend disbelief and think the makeup they're using these days is really darn good, they've nailed it, dude. They've nailed it. So I can only imagine it being better today. What I thought, though, even though I know Disney is not going to use the word prequel, I can almost guarantee they're not going to use the word prequel with this film. I believe Rogue One could be a better prequel to the original trilogy than the prequels were. The original trilogy. That's my feeling.
Yeah.
That's my feeling. That's what I feel.
This is kind of setting up the backstory of the original trilogy, while the prequels were setting up the backstory of Darth Vader. I think that's kind of more...
I'd feel that. Yeah.
I mean, like you were saying, though, the end of Revenge of the Sith was trying to, you know, kind of tie everything together with...
Here's where Leia goes. I like that. That was okay, Alderaan. Okay, Leia goes there. Well, then you got to do Luke. But I think I would have been fine just leaving it there. When they went to Emperor Palpatine and Vader, I'm like, eh.
I also really hated the Grand Moff Tarkin makeup that they have that one guy.
Oh, that was not. It just wasn't done. It didn't suspend disbelief for me. And that to me, you're taken out of this fantasy. And that to me is, don't get me started on the prequels. I'm not slagging. I have issues with them, but I'm also not one who just, you know, gets, you know, terribly upset. We have to accept them for what they are and resolve any issues that we might have with them.
Right.
Because I'm not a hater. I'm absolutely not a hater.
No, I mean, the prequels have their really good moments and they have their really bad moments, but when I saw the prequels, I was young. I mean, I'm, you know, much younger even than I am now. So there's a little bit of nostalgia there for me, and they're the good moments. Except for Attack of the Clones, really. Other than Attack of the Clones, Episode 1 and Episode 3 both have these like nostalgic moments for me. They're like, I can enjoy the movies enough to sit through them again. So
I mean, I'll watch them. I have them. You know, I actually enjoyed the prequels a lot more watching them through this sounds weird, but through her eyes, my wife's eyes, when she saw them for the first time. She didn't have that baggage that I've had, you know. and moreover, I've explained to people too, and I think we've had this discussion before in talking about films and context. When you watch a film at this age and then you watch it 20 years later, you're in a different point in your life, and you watch that film not only with it happening at that time, but even looking at that film is looking at it, you just see it, you see accommodated differently depending on how old you were and what was happening in your life. And it's like all new eyes. Another thing, and we kind of touched upon this when we're talking about Jedi and Sith likely not being involved. The film, we are extrapolating a 2-minute video into however long we're geeking out about this.
Over an hour.
Yeah, but I love it. You know, seemingly it's seemingly grounded. It's reasonable, but there's no magic, and I don't think that's negative. I'm saying that it didn't feel like a typical, like, oh, this is a Star Wars movie, and I'm okay with that.
This kind of feels more like a heist movie or a war movie, even more than a Star Wars movie at this point. Other than the familiar images, I wouldn't recognize it as a Star Wars movie necessarily.
Right, but I think that's where we have to, as fans, and I think it's our not responsibility, but we can't just say, I have an issue with people who do this to anything that's canon, that they're producing for the Star Wars universe. I have a big issue. I understand if you don't want to read the novels. I don't want to necessarily read every single novel that comes out, but that does not make me just automatically push to the side and say it's irrelevant. It's going to be different. And not having that magic, that same magic, doesn't make it any less of what it is. You can't hold it accountable for what it is not. Accept it for what it is. And maybe this is where I kind of resolve the issues that I might have with the prequels. I can't accept them for what they're not. I can only take them for what they are.
Right, right. And I mean, Yeah, the prequels, in that case, I think what really saved them, for me at least, were the familiar characters. The familiar characters and locations and ideas were what made them more interesting than the new locations and new ideas. They had a few new characters that were interesting.
What's fascinating to me is that I was just the opposite. I wanted new stuff. Yeah.
Well, right. I mean, I wanted new stuff, but I really, a lot of people don't like how he had the same characters in the movie. Like, he put C-3PO and R2-D2 as much as he could in there, and all these other characters. Darth Vader was at the end of Revenge of the Sith, maybe a little bit too much. But I thought that if the story didn't make up for it, at least the characters were there to make it feel like Star Wars. But Rogue One is almost the complete opposite for me, where it's going to be something new. But it's going to feel like Star Wars, not the same way that it has in the other movies, but in spirit, kind of there in the background in the universe, while it's not the main focus of the movie.
Yeah. And that, and again, I think we're eye to eye on expectations. To me though, and I mentioned this, I think earlier, Disney's got its work cut out for it in the sense that how do they position it? I think as a Star Wars movie, yes, but this to me is a Star Wars movie that's more Star Wars than Star Wars was. It's like, you're going to have wars and battles and fighting and see, and this is, that's the crux of what we've got in Rogue One. It's just,
right.
it is going to be war. And that to me, I think is what I think a lot of fans may have been missing in the prequels, with it being war ish, but it was more drama with questionable dialogue.
Right, and walking around hallways,
right, and just
quietly talking about politics and all that,
and like I get it, but at the same time, I don't get it. It'll be interesting to me to see how Disney, our business. Let's face it, Star Wars is a business. How Disney positions this, but I have faith that it'll work. And I think to me, the best way to position this for the average person who's not a Star Wars fan, who likes Star Wars and knows of it, I think the best way to do it is to get Vader out there. I think Vader's going to have more pull into this film than the Imperial Walkers, than the Rebel Pilots,
right,
than Mon Mothma, than anything.
Right. I think Vader is
in the Death Star, than anything.
No, yeah, totally. Vader is almost an image that Star Wars has given us that's more recognizable than anything else globally, on a global scale. Yes. Darth Vader is more recognizable than anything else, and that's how they'd sell this movie to people who are questioning if it's going to work as a Star Wars movie or not.
But they can't Phasma Vader in Rogue One. I don't want to see Vader just show up at the end. He can't. I mean, number one, for marketing reasons. Here I am speaking like an entrepreneur with my entrepreneur cap on. Like, they'd just be the stupidest thing that they could do. Is like, dude, you've got one of the most merchandisable characters. Figures that they have is Vader. Vader sells. Like, he sells.
Oh, definitely.
And a lot. Obviously, and I buy. You know, like, I'm like, yeah, I'm in. Like, you know, yes, Vader.
Right.
So I think that it'll be interesting to me to see how it plays out. Obviously, we're going to see Force Friday. They've already pre-announced that.
Have they? I didn't hear about that.
I believe they've talked about it. I think there's a date on Force Friday. At least I've seen it on social. Whether that was officially announced or leaked, I've seen it. I don't know much about it because I sit on the outskirts as a fan. But to me, that actually kind of leads me into another point I made. We will be getting, this is what's kind of exciting as a collector, as someone who likes toys and Star Wars. We're going to be getting a New Hope era toys for the first time or again.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
You know, the Situation Room with Mon Mothma and all these characters. I don't think there's ever a place that made for that. You know, right. We're gonna get those. You know, or we're gonna get
the opportunity that they have to take what they didn't do on the with the first run with Kenner and all that. This is their opportunity to take those ideas and make them a reality now.
Amp it up. You know, but the only thing that disappoints me about that is I'm more of a fan. I don't and I'm fine with creatures, robots, cyborgs, those the human likenesses I'm not as drawn to as a collector, so I'm not excited about that as much. But it's just, it'll be interesting to see how they play it, how they portray it, how they go with it.
Definitely.
And obviously we've seen it. There's a droid that I think is an Imperial droid that's been converted seemingly because it's got Imperial markings. You see it running in behind Jyn and the other
right.
character.
I'm really interested in this new droid that they've introduced. I haven't really listened or looked into it very much. So do you know something?
Yeah, let me see if I can find the timestamp. I don't know anything apart from what I see in context from them running through the
right.
Hang on just a second.
He's also in the background at 29 seconds in.
Is it 29 seconds? Oh, God, it is early on.
29 seconds in, he's in the background. And then the running scene.
Yeah, where's the running scene?
It's at 1 minute and 12 seconds in.
Okay. Really? Oh, there we go. Okay, so there's an Imperial mark, clear Imperial marking on that droid. So why would I don't think that's an Imperial droid. I think that Imperial droid is specifically with Jin and Jin's cohort.
Do you think they tricked the droid or taken it over?
It could be reprogrammed. I mean, it's
reprogrammed. Circuitry.
So my feeling on that droid, that droid could become the BB-8 of this movie. Or the C-3PO or the R2-D2.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, a marketable droid type of character for the movie. So yeah, it'll be exciting to see a New Hope era toys, whether we're talking about vehicles, playsets, figures, you know, and the like. So I'm really excited about that. The only thing, like I said, I want to see more aliens, robots, creatures, because that to me partially makes it less of a war film, which it is potentially, and more of a Star Wars type of movie. I need to see robots, aliens, cyborgs, etc. I need those.
It would sell it as in the Star Wars universe more than just the environments and the familiar images. Just having more droids, even if they're new droids like this one looks to be, the more unfamiliar things that they add that seem like they're from a different place, the more alien it seems, the better, I think.
Yeah, no, I'm totally with you on that. The only last note that I had was that, you know, I believe it's a Star Wars movie, so I don't know if I'm going to be disappointed. I don't think I will be. But given that I like war movies, battle movies, action movies, adventure movies, and Star Wars, to me, it's a win across the board. Like it's just the stage is set. This is going to be a different type of Star Wars movie and has elements that I know I've already enjoyed in other movies. So
oh, yeah, totally.
It's an amalgamation of all those things. So I nothing I can interpolate from here thinking that it's going to be anything but a complete success.
Yeah, no, Star Wars and Indiana Jones are like my two favorite franchises. And I get a little bit of Indiana Jones, not a ton, but a little bit in this teaser here. So anything that they can do to add that Indiana Jones adventure action quality into the Star Wars universe, I mean, there isn't much that they can go wrong with.
I don't know if it's going to be as much of a commercial success as Rogue One. I'm sorry, as A New Hope. The Force Awakens? I don't know if it will be, but I don't think it needs to match The Force Awakens' success to be considered a success. I wouldn't hold it to The Force Awakens.
No. The Force Awakens was, I mean, that was the first Star Wars movie that we had gotten in, what has it been, like 10? It was 10 years, right? But this is a different type of movie. The success of this movie would be if Star Wars fans, I think, accept it into the universe.
Yeah. This isn't a question. Just comics. TV show. It's a film. Like, so if you can't...
Right.
You can't just say, well, the only Star Wars movies that exist are the original trilogy. No, you also have to pay attention to the prequels. You may not like them. You know, you may not have liked all the Highlander movies, but they still existed, like for better or for worse. So
right.
I don't understand that apart from people who are never – this is the way I looked at it even with The Force Awakens. People who didn't like The Force Awakens and found every reason not to like it also didn't necessarily like the prequels. I'm like, well, you don't like anything, do you? You don't like anything because it's quote unquote the same, even though it's clearly not. And you don't like anything because it's different, even though it may very well be. So there are some people you're never going to be able to please.
Right. No. Yeah. I mean, it's a hard audience to, you know, give to, because a lot of the Star Wars fans, they're very dedicated to the saga, right? And if they get something that they don't like, it's very upsetting to them, and I understand why it might be upsetting to them. But if you can't accept it into the universe, because the saga, no matter what, Star Wars is going to move on whether you like it or not.
Well,
the way that they're going.
And my feeling is, and I said this even before The Force Awakens, Disney will continue to, I mean, they'll promote stuff. Notice even with The Force, new things here and there from the prequels, but most of what they may have remarketed was original trilogy stuff, whether it was Darth Vader, very marketable, Yoda, very marketable. These original trilogy characters, even though, yeah, Yoda was in the prequels, but a lot of people identify from the original trilogy.
Yeah.
I think the prequels are going to continue to exist, but continually sidelined. Like as we get more films and more episodic content and more television and more of that, a lot of the prequels, I think that bad taste in not everybody's, I don't want to speak for everybody, but in a lot of fans' mouths,
right.
may just kind of fade into the background. You know, and so I think they can just continue with it as they're doing. I think they've got a good thing. And in the teaser trailer, I'm like, there's nothing that jumped out apart from, you know, what I might have described.
No, yeah. Yeah, I mean it's going in a good direction that I think will please most people. Rogue One's going to be a hit or miss for a lot of people. But it's an anthology film, so you have that opportunity to basically, you know, its own thing. It's not really, it's just its own thing that is connected, but not really.
And I think that to me, it's set people, this is Disney's biggest responsibility, set expectations, man. And I don't know how they're going to do it because they have to be able to present this because it's completely different. We've had seven Star Wars movies that are clearly episodic in nature. Episode 4, you know, Episode 5, these are episodes. This is non-episodic content. And Disney needs to frame this carefully because you don't want to confuse your base, your core, or the people that are going to help it grow. And I think they'll do fine. I'd imagine they've got experts that can help them figure this, navigate this minefield. It's a question of, are people not going to accept it, but are people going to see this as a Star Wars film? And yeah, it says Star Wars in the title, Star Wars Rogue One. Even with a different feel, I just can't imagine people not accepting this as a different type of Star Wars content.
Yeah, we'll see how it works out.
So I've got a couple of questions that most of them are kind of off topic, which is why I kind of shelved them to the end. Joey Adams asked, he clearly said off topic, well, where did you find those figures for $3 each? So I watch for sales. There are groups that I belong to. I watch, you know, lot sales. I don't necessarily buy all of them, but like every once in a while, I'll see in a random group that I might belong to, someone trying to get rid of figures. Like, let's say, Episode 3 series figures, not even worth $5, which I'll pay $5 for, but you can find them on sale. People trying to get rid of them, they can't get rid of them. So they usually sell them for pennies on the dollar. So you usually find better discounts on these types of figures or generally a lot of figures if you buy or you're looking for someone who's trying to get rid of things. They're just $3. And I've been able to get a lot of Power of the Force 2 figures, a lot of, not a lot of Clone Wars figures. A lot of Revenge of the Sith types of figures, Attack of the Clones, and just every so often you get lucky. And these are carded figures. The cards may not be in great condition, but for the most part, I usually pick them up, not for pennies on the dollar, but when you buy or you're looking for sellers who are selling as a lot, and they'll say, I'll sell you any one of these $3 a piece, not including shipping and handling. You can usually get a pretty good bargain on that and on that kind of stuff. Especially catching up on old stuff. I always wait for a good bargain, though. Well, not always. Can't say that. This actually, I will say this, didn't really pay for that. Target that had it, you get the Cartwheel app, and they'll post different deals every week. This was at the store 50% off, and then I earned gift cards through an app that I use that I've talked about. I don't want to like drag that. It's the link's in the video description. I earn points. And then I exchange those points for gift cards. So effectively, I got this by exchanging gift cards and getting it at half off. So it's the 48-inch Jack-specific first-order Stormtrooper that stands in front of the – now it stands at the end of the hallway in front of my daughter Jedi's room, for those who don't yet know me as well. So this is a very large this is a very large, menacing figure who will now sit next to me for the remainder of the video. You can see the other stuff that's back on my desk, stuff that I've got to go through. Okay, so I'm trying to, I want to answer a question that you can address here too. Orlando Makoro asks, I hope Yoda comes out in Rogue One. I hope he doesn't. Your feeling?
No, we don't need Yoda in Rogue One. I understand why you might want characters like that to get the familiar connection like we've been talking about throughout the whole video, but Yoda wouldn't really have any place in Rogue One. He wasn't in A New Hope because he didn't need to be in A New Hope. Yeah, he didn't have a role there. Well, he wasn't in A New Hope because he wasn't made up at that point, but he wasn't important to that story, and I don't think he's going to be important to the heist of Rogue One's stealing Death Star plans. It would be like shoving Chewbacca or Han Solo in there where they don't really fit. So Yoda, one of my favorite characters, I don't think he'd fit in Rogue One.
I agree. It asks, anybody hear about the original? Yes, this was announced today. Alamo Draft House. That was it. Alamo Draft House announced that they're going to be doing something called Return of the Trilogy, and select theaters across the country, national viewers, they're going to be showing throughout August. Unfortunately, Washington is not listed. I tweeted them earlier with a screenshot saying, why is it not happening in Seattle? We got California, Missouri, D.C., California. I've repeated that. Sorry. New York, Florida. Florida gets it and Seattle doesn't.
Seattle has one of the highest concentrations of Star Wars fans. Washington is the second biggest Star Wars
community. I tweeted them, not that for a host. I'm like, I will go on the ground. I'm like, I'll go door to door to theaters. I'm like, knock, knock, knock. Will you run the original trilogy in theaters? I don't know it's probably some kind of back end business deal, but yes, the trilogy is going to be appearing with the Alamo Draft House and their partners across the United States later this year. Exciting. So, I would want to see it.
So is this going to be the theatrical films? I'm guessing.
No. It would probably, I can't imagine them being anything but the Blu-ray. Blu-ray, the latest editions are likely going to be the editions that are going to run. They're not going to special editions, and they're definitely not going to do original run. I don't think. So Nicholas also asks, what if after Rebels we get Knights of the Old Republic series? I don't know. I mean, I like the animated series. I accommodate the cartoons differently than I might like other things that I watch. I see Rebels differently, or even the Clone Wars differently than I do action Star Wars stuff. I enjoy the, it's not my thing though. Them, I like the films for the live action type of thing. It would be interesting. It would be I'd be fine with whatever new animated series or live action series that they come up with. I'm going to be okay with the free. God help me, Stargeek. What the free something? There's a new Lego Star Wars series coming out.
Right.
Free Lego. This is horrible. This is a horrible search. Star Wars cartoon series. It's called the Free Somethings. It's a family. It's a new.
I know what you're talking about. I don't remember the name.
Frack! Come on, I'm gonna new Lego Star Wars cartoon. I'm seeing is the Yoda Chronicles. No. Come on. Okay, here we go. No, that's Droid Tales. Oh. Anyway, there's a new Lego cartoon series that's coming out. I cannot recall its name.
It's centered around, is it a Jedi family that it's centered around?
They're scavengers.
Okay, scavenger family.
Type of family. And I can't remember. I haven't watched it. I like Lego. I love Lego. I'm an adult fan of Lego. I'm still not sure. That's the thing. What would you feel about it? Something more television episodic content cartoons.
You just cut out for a second there. Could you repeat the question?
Sure. Basically, what if after Rebels we get a Knights of the Old Republic series? I was never into the game.
I have a list on my channel of the best video games, and Knights of the Old Republic is up there. But I never really got into it that much. I didn't read any of the books. I don't know a lot of the history. I know about the game a little bit. That's pretty much it. So I don't really have any opinion there. If it's more, it's probably good. I want to learn more about that time period, but I don't know enough about it to really get much of an input there.
See, to me, it would be dangerous because fans already have an issue when retcons happen or changes happen that twist what they've known and loved. And to me, that would be pushing the boundary with something that they know and love, Knights of the Old Republic, which I never got into. That to me, I think would be not divisive. I wouldn't have an issue with it, but I was never into KOTOR. So it's not a thing. And I think that would be, it would serve to, I think, diminish what appreciation one might have for that part of the Star Wars galaxy.
I know what you're talking about. People, the fans of the Thrawn trilogy, which right. I loved a lot, but they were really upset when The Force Awakens wasn't following that same timeline.
Stop. I mean, I'm not telling you to stop. I'm telling the people that are dragging. I'm like, stop. Right.
But, I mean, that would be a risk tackling that universe. If it's not the same, people probably won't like it. So it's probably best to leave it alone.
And I think that's exactly why that character, that Grand Admiral that we're going to see in Rogue One, is not going to be Grand Admiral.
Yeah, I don't see it happening. People would just be too upset about, you know, ruining his story.
Start new and you can't ruin it. Right. And by the way, it's the Freemaker Adventures. I knew Free was involved. The Freemaker Adventures.
Okay.
They've already at Toy Fair, they announced a few of the Lego sets and associated with the Freemaker Adventures. We see Dengar making an appearance, a lot of new characters. It's going to be an animated series. Obviously when it's Lego, it's geared towards like insanely younger audiences.
Definitely, yeah.
Rebels, which is, you know, Disney XD, a little slightly more mature audience, not quite for adults. But, you know, I've watched the Lego stuff off and on. I can't say that I've seen every one of the Lego Star Wars, broadcasts or programs, but they're enjoyable. They're fun. I like Lego. Yeah.
I mean, I like Droid Tales. I didn't really see Yoda Chronicles that much, but I like the video games. It was, like, my favorite video game when I was younger, so... If it's Lego, it's probably, and it'll at least be a fun story.
Right.
Yeah, but I think Lego probably deals a little bit better with the old characters and making them their Lego versions than taking new characters. So I'm not sure how they're going to do with the Freemakers, you said. We'll see.
So another question, the Yuckmouth family, that's the username, which is an amazing username, by the way. Will R2-D2 and C-3PO make an appearance since they were around? I hope not. Again, Vader should show up. Vader is the Death Star. Vader is a New Hope. It would make sense for Vader to show up. For a lot of other original trilogy characters, apart from maybe a cameo at the end with Prince, this is a guess. This is how I would see it playing out. Because think of if they do this right, this becomes a better prequel for A New Hope than the intended Star Wars prequels. Like bringing in a character like I don't think R2-D2 and C-3PO would have a place because R2 was given the plans by Princess Leia on the blockade runner. So if I wouldn't even like it if R2 showed up flanking Princess Leia, because what would bother me about that is if Princess Leia got handed the plans, which makes sense, and then R2-D2 is next to her, why would she not turn around and just plug it into R2-D2 directly? That would bother me. That would
right.
really, really... bother me. I don't think C-3PO and R2-D2 belong in this movie.
No, having listened to the beginning part of the Star Wars radio drama, it's not canon in any way at all. But I like to think that the parts that they don't tell us, you know, you get to kind of make up on your own. And I think that the Star Wars radio drama did a good enough telling of how that happened. And at the end of episode 3, we already see 3PO and R2 on the Tantive IV. We don't really need to get them. I mean, they just wouldn't have a place in Rogue One, even at the end of the movie with Princess Leia. They're the droids. They're like the workers. No. She's the princess of the ship. The only reason she deals with R2 is to save the plans in a small form. He isn't a royal astromech unit in any way, so I don't know. They just wouldn't fit. I'd like to see them again because I love the droids and all that, but they just wouldn't fit Rogue One.
I completely 110% agree. Completely. It's like we think alike. We're separate. You're my brother from another mother. We've got, by the way, Tommy NC 2010 is in the audience. Tommy's like, he gave me the vlogging heavyweight champion of the world belt that I still have. I don't know if you knew that. I am the vlogging heavyweight champion of the world. He's one of the people
I believe it.
Up to. No, Tommy's good people. He's like one of the most genuine, nicest people I've ever met. And he's not necessarily a huge Star Wars geek either. So it's not like I only have Star Wars friends. I just want to put that out there. Although that really puts you ahead. If you like Star Wars, we like. And there's also the handle Geekdom 101. And he's a huge Star Wars fan. And he's given me an inspiration for talking through a few different topics that I've wanted to talk about, like three reasons the prequels were great. Flying in the face of, no, the prequels were horrible. Like, no.
I made the mistake of making a video a long time ago titled Things the Prequel Did Better Than the Originals.
Okay, I don't know if I'd go, I'd be afraid to go that far.
It was a huge mistake. Don't go back.
But I talked about the prequels. There were the introduction of new races. That's always kind of been my thing. But that was my thing. We all have opinions. Sometimes we agree. Sometimes we disagree. But we've had a pretty good audience here. I don't see really too many other questions that I think we could effectively address here. And I know we've pushed over well over an hour and a half. But no, thank you for hanging out. Thank you for
having me on. It's been a lot of fun, and Star Wars is always worth talking about with another Star Wars fan.
Think about it. We basically talked through a full length feature film over a two minute video clip.
I mean, there's just so much to talk about with Star Wars. It never gets old. It never will. So
never will.
I can my original Force Awakens trailer took a 2 minute video and made it into like half an hour. So
So if you want to subscribe to Star Geek, if you haven't already, and you should, there's a link in the video description where you can go. He's also throughout social. You can follow him throughout, including on Twitter. If we need to put any other links down there for you, we will. Anything to say? To kind of round it out, I'll give you the last word.
No, I mean, it's just been a lot of fun talking about Rogue One, and I'm excited to see how it works out in the end. But we'll see.
Good thing, and we still got the full trailer
to look forward to,
and then it becomes a 4 hour long video talking about a 3 minute video. just kidding. I could probably do it though, but I'm just kidding. So anyway, thank you everybody for joining me or us. Sorry. Feel free to Star Wars long enough in one sitting, and you start to get tongue tied. Thank you for joining. I love talking about this stuff. You know, I'm grateful to have someone else to talk to apart from my wife, she can only just in a conciliatory fashion go, and that's it. That's all I get. But I love her. In fact, I don't know if you knew, she snuck in the middle. This is how important Star Wars is. I've got dinner that's been sitting here for about a half hour, and yeah,
I'd rather talk about Star Wars.
You got to be careful. I'd rather talk about Star Wars than eat. That's priorities. It's in Maslow's hierarchy of needs there. Star Wars
priorities there, yeah.
Priorities. So thank you, everybody, for joining us. I love you. I appreciate you. But at this point, I'm going to leave you, or we will leave you, to your own devices.